It's probably good to first look at some of the chops again, just to give you a general idea of what's in there. The chops are basically, as I showed you before, again, we have this differentiation between generators in the darker colors and filters in the lighter colors. And those generators could be an audio device in, which you see here, my microphone, as a mono or a stereo channel, or even multi-channel if it's a multi-channel sound card. A filter that would be a good application for, or that would be a good fit for this, could be, for example, the audio spectrum chop, which outputs the spectrum of the incoming audio source. So this is something very useful for audio visualizations. We have, what I maybe should mention here on the audio spectrum chop, there's a difference between two different modes, two different general modes. One is the spectrum for visualization. So it's a normalized spectrum in a way that while higher frequencies often come in with less intensity, with less amplitude. So theoretically, if you look at a true representation of the spectrum, which is the time to magnitude and phase mode in the audio spectrum, you see that you get you pick up a lot of the lower frequencies with high values, but the higher frequencies are very hard to distinguish. So it's not as easy to use for visualization, but this is actually a mathematically correct representation of the spectrum, meaning that this allows me actually to go from the spectrum, if I attach another spectrum and say magnitude to time, it allows me to go to the spectrum and then convert the spectrum back into audio. So you could do manipulations on the spectrum itself. You could cut out certain frequencies. You could switch them around, the frequencies, if you wanted, and then convert it again into audio. While the other mode, the visualization mode, here you see that also the higher frequencies are displayed with a good, for visualization purposes, in a good range. So that's the audio spectrum. You also have a bunch of other audio-based filters here. Audio filter, namely, for having low, high bandpass filters. We do have an audio dynamics, which we'll be using in a second for compressing and limiting your audio. You have a parametric equalizer, things like that. There's an audio render, which is quite interesting, as it gives you, it basically calculates 3D sound for you. So you can do 3D sound installations with locating sound based on geometry objects. So if you have a rendered scene, you can connect sounds basically to these objects, and while you move them around in space, the sound is being rendered to represent that position. That's a quite interesting feature for installations especially. And then there's audio stream in, stream out, so you can stream across devices. Something that's being used quite a bit in theater currently, but it's only available on commercial licenses, is the Black Tracks chop, which allows input for tracking data on stage. So people would, actors on stage would get a beacon, and it's being tracked over the stage, so you get position for each of these beacons. A good example actually for that is this video here, if I might just show you. So you have the two actors here, and they're being tracked, and therefore the visualization follows follows their position on stage. You can see that especially here, where the actor directly controls the projection. I think it's a Toronto-based company, by the way, Black Tracks, that does that. Other things of interest, I showed you previously as well that a lot of the devices are coming in via chops. So you have, if you want to get certain keyboard keys in, then here, for example, picks up the key number one. This is one way of getting keyboard signals in. Oh, I have that. That's a good example. There's this little device here, which is kind of fun to work with. It's called the Makey Makey. It's just plugs in via USB, and it pretends to be a keyboard. So the funny idea about this thing is that you connect it to various, you have various connectors on it, which are assigned to keyboard keys. And then if you attach this to any conducting material, like a tree or like any plant material or fruits or whatever, then when you touch these objects, you get basically keyboard channels coming in. So here I map them to the number keys. I don't have a banana, otherwise I could show you how that works. Makey Makey. I think this also we got from Creatron.
Creatron,
yeah. The nice thing about this one is also it's just a keyboard device, so there's no there's no extra protocol or anything in that. I didn't mention that before, but because I see it, I'm just gonna say it now. I didn't bring it because it's just my backpack was full. This connectivity inside touch, despite the Kinect being out-faced. We have a Kinect top, which brings in the color image, and as well as the point cloud of the Kinect. So you get all the 3D data, and you get all this 3D data via top, because it's an image, actually, that the Kinect provides. But all the tracking data, all the joint tracking data, comes in via the Kinect shop. We're working on the implementation of a camera which is called... Anyway, there's another company that came out with a very nice small device. It's not the RealSense. We do support the RealSense as well, but another device that's much more comparable to the Kinect, which replaces the Kinect for a lot of installations. I mentioned the Leap Motion. We do have MIDI ins. Connecting MIDI and touch is fairly simple as well. I did bring a little MIDI board with me, which plug it in. It's the launch pad, the mini launch pad here. And you have to set up that device initially. And to connect to MIDI devices, you would go to Dialogues. And then there's a MIDI device mapper. Brings up a little dialogue, and you create a new mapping. You can select the in device. It should show up automatically. In my case, it's the Launchpad Mini. And now if I press any buttons on it, I already can see the data streaming in here. And I also see now that I have these channels available as control channels in chops. So I can again export that to anything or drive. For MIDI, perhaps there's another way of bringing this data in, which would be the MIDI in DAT. the benefit of using the media in depth for certain things is that it comes with a callback. So every time I hit a button on here, this callback is executed, a script, and I can write my own function here, basically. And do something in Python with that MIDI command. If exporting the channel is not enough. MIDI. And then also chops are used to generate. We looked at the noise already. So noise channels, which follow in their parameters very much what the noise top was doing, but here as a two-dimensional data. Never sure if this is two-dimensional, but I mean I've got time and amplitude, so I consider this to be two-dimensional, but anyway. Various noise types, including random, which limits your parameters quite a bit. For a lot of these noise types, though, you also have the transform parameters here, so you can drive these, you can create also these kind of organic noise values with it. You can create noise for audio as well, which would be the audio oscillator, which actually creates at 44,100 or any frequency you sample rate you specify. And this also lets you create white noise, basically. But these noise channels in general are not just for audio, but also for selecting random values from other parameters. If you wanna draw something that's not quite straight or evenly distributed, those noise channels can come in handy because you can add those noise values to the position of points, for example. So it has various uses outside of audio. We do have the pattern chop, which creates simple waveforms. It might not be, it's kind of, I can create multiple channels and offset these channels by certain values. Every new channel that's created would be offset by something. So this would be, despite there being also a circle sop, which we'll get to later, sops in general, I could use channels, for example, to create a circle myself. And this would be a good point, by the way, if I wanted to make this circle a little bit noisy or something like that. Just have random. We have here as inputs and sampling points. I don't want that, but let me just create two noise channels here with a small amplitude. If I add those together, and because I didn't take care of the lengths of the channels, I'm just gonna do this. And now if I increase the amplitude here, you see that by adding noise to my other two channels, I can basically control, go from a circle to some a strange other shape. So the pattern can create these kind of waveforms. It can be useful for lookup curves as well. If you want to create a nice, for example, a slider. If you use the Arduino example that I had previously to control to get your control values in. Let me just show you that. Might be useful to see. I'll bring in the Arduino again. Fermata. And COM3. Port analog pins. Null. So I'm just going to select out the first channel. And now there's a chop called the trail chop, which is really useful because you can record over time and you can kind of visualize what your incoming channel, what it looks like over time. And now I would like to have this not such a linear 0 to 1. You don't want to have these as such a linear curve, but maybe you want it to be more, maybe it should look actually like this, like at the lowest it should be -1 when my putty is all at the minimum. My value should be -1, then I want it to go up to 1, and then when it's at the maximum I want it to go back to -1. And this can be done with these kind of where you create the lookup curve essentially. And then via a chop called a lookup. Now if you watch them, if I move my putty, oh, and I'll show you the original putty curve is the, or the original putty values are coming in as the third channel here. So now when that goes up, the first channel is now actually a sine and the second channel is a cosine. So I can, with the help of the pattern chop, I can create nice lookup curves for remapping other values. Then, similar to the pattern chop, but with a little bit more control, I should probably mention the pattern chop also is just great for creating shapes or curves easily, because you give it a certain length, and that's the number of samples that you're getting that are being created. So you just have to say, okay, I need a channel with 1,000 samples, and you put that into the length, and that's it. And then you have all the other controls like phase. You can do tapering off the channel. So you have lots of control over how this channel should look. A similar chop, but with more control, especially looking for at lookup curves, is the S-curve chop, which now gives you control over steepness of the curve. So I can something that would be much more difficult to create with the pattern, you have more control over here. So again, this is a great tool for creating lookup curves when controlling animations, or even when you're outputting it to other devices, motors or whatever. Lookup curves are, that's that's where we want to be looking at for creating those. And then of course things like the various protocols that we are, that Touch understands. I did have the I did show you the MIDI note before. This one would be the OSC note. There's a nice little program that you can get for your phone, which is called Zixim. And Zixim is, yeah, you just load it up on your phone, and it's available for, I think, iPhone and Android. And then you punch in the IP number of your computer, and then it's sending all the sensor data, all the sensors that you have in your phone, it sends over to your computer as an OSC channel. So if my IP hasn't changed, which I believe it didn't, then I just need to change the port number to 50,000 here, because that's what in the settings of the program it has. And now you see that I get my acceleration, I get gravity sensors, the gyros are coming in, I get the multi-touch from my phone, so you can quickly use your phone as a multi-touch input device, as well as using all the sensors that are in your phone to control installation. It's the OSC in job, and the program is called Zixim. Maybe I'll write it out. It's a good one to remember. Zixim. And OSC also, I guess, when you're talking to or communicating with Ableton or Max MSP or other software, then often the communication protocol will be OSC for these things. Yeah, we already covered the mouse in, and so I mean there's a vast amount of different generators, also the converting subs, the surface operators, back into like 3D geometry into channel data. You would find that as a generator sub 2, and as well the top 2, which converts image data back into channel data. So you would get, for sampling, you would sample certain pixels in your image, and that would be returned then as color values, simply to be shown. If I, here on the example of 3D data, it's taking these point values and converting it again into channel values. And if I take an image, movie file in, and use the top two, then I get a scan line. In the default settings, I would get a scan line of this image here. So currently it's fetching the center, which you can control over the via the parameters. So all the pixel values of one row of pixels here. The top two takes an input, which is sampling coordinates. So you can actually specify coordinates in your image where you want to sample colors from. So let's say you only want this pixel, and this pixel. You could input the UV position, so it's a normalized 0 to 1 position of these pixels here, and then you would only get the information for these 3 pixels. This is really useful when you're dealing with LEDs, for example, where you have an LED grid, and you want to put an image on those LEDs. Then on an LED grid, if you have, for example, a spiral, an LED tape kind of thing that you made in a spiral, then you could input as sampling points into the top two the positions of the spiral, and then it would fetch you only the colors for actually those points. Maybe I'll later get to a... I should have an example of that somewhere that's where that becomes clear. But yeah, the top two is one of those nodes that you definitely will use when using LEDs with Touch Designer, when you're driving LEDs. And then we get from the generators to the filters. And there's a vast amount of filters in chops, because chops are essentially a very powerful tool for logic operations as well, like building AND operations, or any kind of logic operations essentially. And the most used ones obviously would be the math chop, which holds a lot of the math operations, as I showed you. Then we have a function chop, which has options to do various other math operations, square roots, trigonometry things, logarithmic powers, as well as converting between decibel to power, etc. We have a very useful chop, which is the analyze chop, which can give you average values, maximum minimums, the position of peaks when you're analyzing spectrums, for example. Then it's often good to know where certain peaks are in the frequency spectrum, where you would find peaks. This can be done with the analyze as well. And it also gives you the RMS power, which is a good indication of power of an audio signal. So if you want to do an audio visualization where you need the amplitude of the incoming sound wave, then the RMS power is a good... is a good way to get to that. What else do we have here? Right, we have filters. Filters are extremely useful to smoothing out, when smoothing out data. And again, I will be using a trail chop here just to show what's happening. So when I move my mouse, you see that the data is kind of jaggy, and when you work for an in an installation, then often you want that data to be smoothed out to have nicer movement, and this is where filters come in. So there's a filter chop, which now smooths the data very nicely compared to the input data. On the bottom you see the input data, on the top the smoothed version of it. And you have control over the filter widths, so you can make it very responsive and not so smooth, or you can make it ultra smooth, where a lot of these peaks are not being picked up at all. Similar to the filter, but different in behavior, is the lag chop. The lag chop, well, as the name says, it lags a value, so it basically eases in to the new value that it's getting, and then eases out to it as well. Okay, so let's compare this to the input. It gets much quicker to the final value. So it follows even those short or those quick movements, it follows pretty nicely, but it smooths in between. Lags are really nice for animations. If you're moving something, and you don't want it to start abruptly or end abruptly, like you move a box from left to right, then with a lag you can kind of let the acceleration build up to the maximum acceleration, and then just before it hits the end you slow it down again. That would be done with a lag. And another good one would be the trigger chop. And the trigger chop is essentially an ADSR envelope generator. For people that are familiar with music, then an ADSR should ring a bell. It's basically, you trigger it, and then you have a certain time that the trigger will reach a peak value. Then it will stay at the peak value for a certain time and go to a sustain value, go down to a sustain value. And then when you release the input trigger, it will release back down to the default value. So this looks like that. Goes up to a peak value, stays there for a while, goes to sustain, and only when I release the input, when I set the input to zero again, will it go back down to its default value. And this can be controlled over those pages here, the attack, sustain, and the trigger page. So if I actually disconnect the input, time slicing off, you can kind of see what kind of envelope it creates. It's an ADSR, it's called. But the chop that generates it is called a trigger chop. And, right, I have been talking about logic a lot, so there's a logic operator which converts the input to be for example, convert the input off when zero or less. So this is going to be off whenever my channel is below zero or zero. And as soon as I hit anything, a positive value, it's going to turn on. It's going to go to one. And then it doesn't matter how high I go. It's just going to be on one. There's other things you can do with the logic. What the hell? You have various other operations here. Only be off if it's outside a certain value range. On when the value changes. So if my incoming value changes in any way, then the logic should be on. And you can, yeah, you have a couple operations for the channel itself where you can make it, for example, a toggle. Toggle meaning every time the channel turns on, the logic's gonna say it's on. Now when I turn it on again, it's gonna go off. Turn it on, it's gonna go on again, and so on. So that's a toggle. It's like a little button, basically, that you have to click. And that continues with various other functions here, as well as the traditional logic functions for combining channels or combining chops together. And the last one I'm just going to show now is the fan chop. The fan chop is a little bit funny. It takes a single channel and it can split up the channel into multiple channels. Meaning, when I increase the value of the incoming channel, the higher I get, the next channel turns on. So when I'm, the behavior is currently that if I'm outside of the index that it sets the, what was it, clamp index. Now I set it to set channels to zero. So if I go below zero, that is, yeah, everything is off. And as soon as I, as this value rounds to zero, the first channel is on. As soon as this value rounds to one, the second channel is on. As soon as it rounds to two, the third channel is on. So this gives you, for example, the possibility when you have, let's say you have a slider, like a physical slider that you move from left to right. And depending on which position you are on the slider, you want a certain video to play. Then this is an easy way to control playback of, in this case, eight different videos. Because the further you move, you turn the play of another video on or off. And the fan shop can also fan in, which is just the same operation in reverse. So you take a number of input channels, and depending on what channel is on, it's going to tell you the index of the channel that's currently on. What's a little bit different about the chop viewers compared to all other viewers is that there seems to be two different types of displays. One is this display where you see a value and a channel name, while the other one is where you see channel data over time. Like probably also best to see in the pattern chop here. And the difference is that in this mouse in chop here, I only have one value per channel. So I have a single value here. The length of this channel is one sample. Only one single sample. This one here, the length is set to 1,000, so I have 1,000 data points. It can be better seen if I limit the length quite a bit. Now the length is 10, so now I have 10 data points here. You can already kind of tell this by how this curve looks, how with all the corners here. And if I activate the viewer of the pattern chop, I can also display those sample values here. So you see this one has 10 samples in it, 10 discrete values. Everything in between is just interpolated. A good way also to showcase this is by converting this into a DAT. So now you see the 10 values that are within this channel as numerical values, actually. While if I would attach this to the chop too, I have two values, one for each channel, but that's it. No, each channel has just one value. So that's the difference between those two display types. Chops also have various forms of outputting data. So you have the audio device out, where you can play back music. So if I take an audio file in here, it's playing a default file, and I want to listen to this, I can just place an audio file out. Where is it? I'm blind. Audio device out. So you can output audio. You also can output MIDI. There's a MIDI out. So when your device, this is good for motorized sliders, for example, or motorized fader controls, as well as some of these things, you can control the color of these buttons when they light up. So you can control these things with the MIDI out as well. And what other outputs do we have here? I think that's pretty much it as the for the because the rest is like time codes and syncing and things we're not going to get into. Similar to what I said earlier, that touch relies a lot of on recipes or on techniques. This is especially true for chops. You get into a mode where you can take a problem apart and put it back together in chops, like describing basically the problem that you're trying to solve in a chop network. A lot of it, personal opinion basically, what's nice about it is that still we use the same idea that every viewer shows what, every node shows in its viewer what the chop is actually doing. So it's helpful to grasp certain content, to grasp certain things easier. Like, we kind of learned that in high school that the circle is built out of a sine and a cosine, but it becomes really clear when you can visualize it, in my opinion, that tx values, all the tx values, how they look like, and how the ty values look like when you start from a certain point. So chops can be really helpful also to understanding certain concepts when you're building them out, because every viewer visualizes exactly what it's doing, what the node is doing. Right, so let's try to build our little sound matrix. And for that, just open up a fresh file. And the first thing we would start with is probably build this little slider thing, which is not necessarily a chop, but a component. Right in the beginning, I showed you that there is panel-related components here in the center. And so let's select the slider component. And yeah, bring up the upgrade dialog via tab or double-click or however. And in the comp section, find the slider comp, which is in the center column, fairly at the bottom. So the slider comp, it's a little bit hard to use if it looks like this, because I don't have access to the slider. I cannot control it. If you want to control the slider, turn the viewer active flag on, and now you have control over the slider. You can actually use it. If you roll your mouse over the right hand side of this box, then you see a little output comes available, and just right click onto that output and add a null chop. If it's hard to find this output, then you can always disable the viewer again, so that you get the frame back and you see the output on it. I enable the viewer again, and you see that when I move the slider, the value of the output changes between 0 and 1. So this is a one-dimensional slider, which we would have to convert into a two-dimensional slider. And this is going to get interesting, but it's a very quick fix. First of all, the size of the slider is kind of funny. It's elongated, and I need a square kind of slider. For panel components, I can change their look on the layout page. So select the slider, and in the parameters, go to the layout page, and you see that you have a width and a height there. So if you change the height to 100 as well, now you have a big square slider that has still just one horizontal knob, or a knob that can only be moved horizontally. So let's go inside this slider. Because this being a component, you can actually go into it. So you can hit enter, to enter it, and you should see that you're in Project 1 Slider 1. And what we find inside this slider is another container called knob and some chops. This one is a panel chop, which the panel chop basically fetches all the available panel values that a control panel can give you. So it would be mouse position, it would be states, like if you're rolling over the container currently or the UI element, things like that. Okay, and the first thing would be that my width and my height should probably be the same, because I just want this little tiny, like a small knob that I then want to move around, like a square knob. So I want to change this here, this height parameter, and I want to set it to 5. Now the thing is that this parameter looks funny because it's not gray, but it has a dark background and a bluish text in it. This indicates that this parameter is using an expression, a Python expression. If I want to see this Python expression, I can click on the name and it opens up this field below it. And there's some expression that gets the height of the parent container, but I don't need this right now. I just want to have it 5, the size of 5. Now I have a little square knob. One question that probably comes up right away is, it would be really useful to see my slider at the same time when I'm manipulating it, like when I change sizes in it and stuff. And one way to look at, one way would be, I go out again to my Project 1 network. So when I'm inside here, I can either click U to go up, or I can use the scroll wheel to go up. And then if the slider is active, if the viewer active flag is on, right click on the name and say view, or select view from the menu. And this gives me a little window, which is my slider, and I can resize it so I can use it better. And it's interactive. I can control the slider with it. And the problem is that I currently still can only move this little knob that we created left and right. I only have horizontal there. So I'll go back into the slider. And now just follow along with me here while I do this. There's an X and an Y position for the slider. If I move this knob around, you can see that this value here changes. And it changes based on the panel's U value. So that's the horizontal position of the mouse, basically. And it does some math to it, which is not really that important. But let's take this expression. So click on the X parameter here so you see this expression. And let's copy this expression and paste it into the Y. Okay, so now if I move along here, it's moving diagonally, because both values are now exactly the same. And the one thing I want to change right now is change the parent.panel.u. I don't want the U coordinate, but I want the V value of it. So change parent.panel.u, take the U out and replace it with V. And having done that, you should be able to move this knob around as you would expect from a 2D slider. This is how much scripting we'll do today. So that's the only thing. Well, okay, we could fix it a little bit more. Width should be height. And me.par.panel W should be me.par.panel H. Because for the Y we're referencing the height and not the width, so that's why. But yeah. Okay, so I have a nice 2D slider here. By the way, what I just did, you can resize your parameter window by grabbing the edge. If you want to see an expression fully, you can just drag it out. But one thing that's still missing is that currently I only get one value here. I only get the U value. I don't get, or the horizontal value. Aptly named V1, which stands for value 1, not to be confused with the V direction here. So I only get the left to right. But if you go onto the panel chop, then you see that you can select various channels from the panel. And the channel that we want to select as well is V. So you have U for the horizontal and V for the vertical. And now you see that in the bottom corner it's 0, 0, bottom right it's 1, 0, top right 1, 1, top left 0, 1. And we have a 2D slider. Did everybody follow along with that?
See the
XY
again as well.
Sure. So I copied this one and then I replaced the U with a V.
My X doesn't look like that, so I'm just gonna leave it.
Oh.
Vowel parent.
Is it?
After vowel times parent.
Yeah.
I just get par panel.
Yeah, other panel values also include things like click, an indicator if you clicked onto a UI element, a click count, how many times you clicked on it in a certain time span. There's things for radio buttons, so you know which button in a radio group was clicked, things like that. Okay, so we can leave this we can leave the scripting behind. And it should look like this now for all of you. Two channels coming out of the button with it following the position where you're at. So now we need to divide this thing up into regions. I downloaded 25 of these sound samples, so that's a 5x5 grid. And how can we tell from two channels which section I'm currently on? So the first thing would be that I make integers out of this, so that I have 0 to 4 instead of 0 to 1 in the horizontal and in the vertical scale. Because then I basically know if I'm in row 0, column 0. If I move a little bit right, I know I'm in row 0, column 1, etc. So I can attach a math chop here. Math. And the math chop has an option to change everything to an integer via this integer parameter. So select round for the integer. So now if I cross the halfway point, it turns to 1, otherwise it's 0. Same with going up. And now, because I want 5 of these sections, currently I have 2, I have 0 and 1, so I need to multiply the whole thing by 4. So to multiply these values, go to the multi-add page of the mask chop and multiply this by 4. So 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, horizontally and vertically. Okay, again, now, how can I tell which, how can I put this into a sequence number? Because I want to know, this one would be my first sample, my second, third, fourth, fifth, and then up here, this should be my sixth sample. So I somehow need to take the row that I'm in and multiply the row by the number of columns I have, and then add the current column number to it. So you take the current row zero, multiply that by 5, which is 0, and add the current column. So 1, 2, 3, 4. Now if I go into the next row, multiply this by 5 plus the column, I'm at 5. By 5 is 5 plus 1 is 6, and so on. So I can create a sequence out of these numbers by selecting out the column, the row, which would be V2. So let's add a select chop to the output of the math. And by channel names, select V2. Because this is here which row I'm in. And to this, on the output, right click and select the math chop. And multiply this value by 5. So 0, 5, 10, 15, 20. And now to this value of which row I'm in, I want to add which column I'm in. So let's just add a new branch here where we select V1. And to add a new branch, that was middle mouse clicking onto the output of the math. So if I middle mouse click, the upgrade dialog comes up. I can get a math. Oh, sorry, not a math, a select. Again, middle mouse click, select. And select out V1, which is my column number. And now I need to add this value onto this value. Or this onto this, or whichever way around, doesn't matter. And to combine these two, I can again use a mask chop. So right click on the output of the mask 2 and find the mask again. And this is a chop where I can connect multiple other inputs to. So the select 2, which selects V1, is going to be connected to this math 3 as well. And then on the parameters of this math chop, I have the combined chops parameter, which lets me basically tell this chop what to do with these input channels, how to deal with these input channels from each input. And I want to add those. So combine chops add. There's a difference between combining channels and combining chops. Combining channels would be something if I have multiple channels in a chop and I put a math on it and I combine the channels, then it adds those two channels together or these multiple channels that are in that chop already. But if I have two inputs to the math chop, then I want to combine these two chops together. That's why it's important to use the add on the combined chops and not on the combined channels. Okay, and if I now go along here, if I go along my slider here, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, and so on. Up to 24. So from 0 to 24, and I basically have a gridded, an indexed grid. So each cell has a certain ID, basically.
Is the point actually common, the node functions?
Yeah, it's not a very nice. Okay, here it comes again. We're working on a better version of that. We finally will introduce boxes like commenting in the background. For now, there's this little on the parameter, there's a little edit comment section, and when you click on it, you can say this selects my row. And now this node has a little flag, there's a little blue speech bubble on top, which tells you that there's a comment in it. And you can see the comment by middle mouse clicking onto the node as well. It's up here. And at the end of this, I'm going to attach a null for now. And that's the first step then for our little music grid. Does everybody have that? Any questions on that? I mean, what the... you see that this is basically... figuring out how you would solve this problem. It's not necessarily about a touch designer specific way of using this. It's more about trying to analyze what we need to do to control 25 different sounds. I need to know which sound to play at which position. So from two values, I somehow have to get to one value which tells me exactly an ID of a sound file, essentially. So this part is just, well, we've been using a lot of math, so this is basically just math doing exactly what we did. Yeah. For the next part, I would like to bring in all these audio files that I have in the that I have in the folder that I gave you. And one way, but that would be not a particularly nice way, would be to just go to the folder and drag them in. But that's not very, it's not the way we want to do this. You could, theoretically, you could just grab them all, oops, and just drag them all in. It does that. But we want to have a more generative approach to this so that when you change those files, that they automatically change. Or if you add more files or something, then you can do that as well. And a note that's going to help us is, we haven't used that yet, is in the dot section of the upgrade dialog, and it's called the folder dot. So open up the upgrade dialog and find the folder dot, first column, bottom third. And the folder that basically lets me browse folders. So it gives me a list of files in a certain folder, being the root folder here. The nice thing about it is that it has a refresh option, which means this that actually refreshes. If you add more files into that folder, that file's gonna show up automatically. So you can act on it. You don't need to refresh manually. And now as the root folder, browse to the folder that holds these audio samples. So for me, that's in the Dropbox, here. Media, SoundLib. And the whole thing should look similar to this. It has a name and a path by default. If you check the column section in the parameters of the folder, that you can display quite a bit more information if you want to. Yeah, more information of the file. The other thing you can do is, if you have a folder where you have not just audio, but you also have movies and whatever in it, you can turn off all extensions parameter and just select the extensions that touch supports of a certain context, like audio or movies or images. So here we would select audio. And let's attach a null dot to that. Now the question would be, how can I use this data to automatically create all my audio file in operators that I want to load these audio files in? And to do this, we'll be using something called a replicator. And a replicator is a really powerful thing because it takes a table or just a number of, you can just give it a number as well, but mostly probably it's used by a table. And then depending on the number of rows in the table, it's gonna copy the, it's gonna copy a reference node that many times. So let's place down a replicator, and the replicator is a replicator component. So open up the upgrade dialog, then go to the component section and find the replicator in the last column. And the replicator takes a template table, template dot, which would be my null. So I can drag this null onto that parameter, onto the template.table parameter. And then it also takes a master operator, and this master operator is the operator from which it would create the replicants from. So let's get an audio file in. Chop. And place it right beside the replicator. Now I'm just going to turn off the play parameter of this because I don't want all of them to start playing right away. And now I can reference this audio file in as the master operator to my replicator. So I take the audio file in, drop it onto the master operator, and it created 25 of them automatically. The from the
when you import the when you open the audio file shop.
Right. So what I did is that's funny. Let me just remove those. Whoops. Okay. So what I did is I created an audio file in, then selected the replicator, and then dragged the, oh sorry, on the audio file in I also turned off play, just as a
turn off.
Turn, yeah, the play parameter on the audio file in I turned off. And then I selected the replicator and drag that audio file in shop onto the master operator parameter. So you can drag the whole node onto this parameter, which basically just fills in the name for you.
I'm not sure that it's not allowing me to actually create the folder. The folder.
The null dot in this case is more for style. It has nothing, has no functionality again. It's more something that I got really used to do. So it should look similar to this to for you. Does everybody have that? And if it's in your case as well that there's like overlaps and it's in a funny position, it has this layout origin. The replicator has these layout origin parameters, which you can, where you can basically adjust where it should place those nodes, where to start placing those nodes. So I could move them a little bit around just to have them out of the way of my other network. Now I realized that I lied about the scripting part. I do have one more little tiny expression that I need you to write. But the thing is that the replicator, what it did, it took the audio file in and created complete copies of this audio file in, including also the file name, the default file name that it gets. But we don't want this default file. We want it to, for each of them, to pick a file from this table here. Because here we have all our file names, actually. So we have a couple things. We have an audio file in that's called item one. And the name, the item, comes from operator, from this parameter called operator prefix. So it takes item and then it puts an index on it. And we can get to this with an expression to the one, to the index, which is very useful. because with that index, we can basically look into this table and say, okay, if my index, if my name is item one, my index is one, so return to me the path in the first row, or sorry, in the row with the ID one. So the second row here. And that expression will be typing into the audio file in one, into the audio file in that we created initially, that we referenced with the replicator. So select the audio file in one. Click on the file parameter to open up the expression. And now comes a simple expression. What we want is, we want to go to this null three operator here. So we'll type OP, open parentheses. Now comes the name of the operator. So we need to put a little, what do you call that thing? It's like a single, single quote, I guess it's called. Yeah, single quote. And now type the name of this dot, null three. For me, it's called null three. I'm not sure what it's called for you. Null three. And again, a single quote and close parentheses. So this gives us access to this operator, up null three. We now have access to this. And now the syntax to get to a cell, to a certain cell in that dot, would be open square bracket. And now we define the rows, and the row would be me.digits. Me.digits is an expression which basically returns this, the number in the name of the operator. Me.digits. So that's the row. And then comma, and now we can get to the column. And the column actually has a name. The column is called path. So we don't have to type in the number of the column, but we can type in the name of the column. And the name again is a string, so we need a single quote. Then type path, single quote again. And close square bracket. That's
so
it.
Would this code will reference all the 24 files? Or?
Yeah, so currently we've done it with the audio file in one that creates all of the other ones. So that would be the next step now. If I select the replicator, there's an option down here that says recreate all operators. And once I click that, now you see all these lines here that connect the null three to all the other audio files. And now you see here the audio file in that's called item eight has the same expression, but it's referencing a certain file.
The individual files,
correct, yeah. So the audio file in expression, if you have that, click on the replicator, recreate all operators. And you can double check if that's true by just going to random ones of this audio, of these item called audio file in jobs, and see that they're referencing different audio files. Everybody have that? Now we have all these audio files. None of them are playing currently. When we want to output those audio files, we could either output each via its own device out, like output it onto the sound card for each separately, or we could merge them all together, combine them all, and then have one audio out device. And that's probably the most sane approach here. And combining those files would be via a mask chop again. And this mask chop, we would be adding them together. There's only going to be one or two or three playing anyway at a time, but we'll be fading between them as well. So we're not going to get a huge crazy mess happening. So we can safely combine them all with a mask chop. And a way to...
Yep. Question. The audio files is only waveform or MP3s?
For audio, we accept wave, AIFF, MP3. AU.wave, yeah. So to combine them, let's create a mask chop. And now instead of having to connect each individual one to this mask chop here, we can just select all of them. So with the right mouse button, you can select all of them. And then select the input of one. And connect it to the, select the output of one of them. And connect it to the input of the math, and all of them should be connected at once. So you can create these nice looking networks with lots of nodes connecting to one node. And now you see that we have all these channels from all these audio file in operators. We now have all the channels in this mask chop. And here's where we need to combine them again, and we did that before via the combine chops add in the mask chop. Combine chops add.
I'm getting further. When I select all of them and then drag one to connect to the mask, it just connects one because it connects the rest of it. It didn't go out to select at all.
Ooh.
Let it all first, and then I select it.
going to be printed.
Okay, so we should have the combined chops add, which adds all of these together. And we follow this up with an audio device out. And if I now go to one of them and turn play on, I can play it. Or another one. The last chop is an audio device out. Audio device out chop. Now there's a chance that we have multiples of them playing at the same time, and we want to prevent totally trash our sound system. So in between the math 4 and the audio device out, we can add in an audio dynamics to limit the whole signal, to just keep it in a valid range, keep the amplitude in a valid range. So on the output of the math 4, I'm gonna right click and find the audio dynamics chop. Audio dynamics, it's the first column. And on the limiter page of its parameters, just turn on the limiter, enable the limiter to on. Also compress it, doesn't matter right now.
So you have to do that for individual files?
No, just the one audio dynamics, because that's the, you add them all together and then you make sure that it doesn't, yeah. Okay, so what we should have, what everybody should have now is, we have our sound library essentially, none of them are playing, and we have here our little slider, where we want to select which one is playing currently by index. And how do we control if it's playing? We control it via the play parameter. And the crossfading we can control via the volume parameter here. But I only have one channel and I need 25 channels. And that's the perfect job for the fan chop. The fan chop was one of those when I, depending on the value of the input, it turns on an output channel. So after this null 2 here, let's add a fan chop. That's after the null 2 of our XY slider. A fan. And currently it creates 8 channels. So it goes from, we have the bottom column and we have a little bit of the second, the bottom row and a little bit of the second row as well. But we want to have all of them, so we need 25 channels. And you see here this syntax, it's creating 8 channels, channel 1 to channel 8. So instead of the 8, let's type a 25. And it should create 25 channels, and when you move around in your slider, you should be able to see that you're going, that you can reach each of these channels basically. That's the fan out. Yep.
When you connect your map to audio,
audio device out.
Before the dynamic. Okay, audio dynamic.
Yep.
Mine both audio out and that one has an X, and I can't figure out why.
An X.
try the rank. So how do you do it?
Did you, do you have the fan job?
Yeah, what's that?
The fan job?
Yeah, I added that already.
So, okay. So we want to crossfade between the, between when playing them, we want to crossfade between all of these. Yeah, let's try the play first. So let's, after the fan, let's add a null chop. Because we always export from nulls. And well, the issue would be that we now would have to take this, each channel, and drag it onto the play parameter of each of these chops, which is way too much work. So we can automate that a little bit. And the automation is done by an export mechanism where you can name those channels correctly, and if you name them correctly, specifically by operator name followed by the parameter that they should be exporting to, you can just export via that method. So you don't have to drag, you just say export those channels, and the channel gonna look at its name and determine, okay, the first part is the path, the second part is the parameter that I want to export to. Meaning, if I change this name here from channel 1 to item 1 colon play, then this channel will know that it will have to export to that parameter of the item 1 chop. Item 1 being my first file. And renaming channels can be done with a rename chop. So after the fan, before the null, add a rename chop. And the rename chop by default comes with a little warning. The warning basically saying, oh, it has no effect. So it's not much of a warning. Now, how can I rename those easily? I don't want to type in all these channel names. I can use pattern matching for that, and this is simple pattern matching. It's basically you type in chen and then the star that was already there. And what this means now is that it takes the base of chen and star, it matches any of these numbers here. Anything that comes after chen, not just numbers, anything that comes after chen. And this star, basically whatever in this star is now available to you in the two field. So here we can say item star colon, and I know that the parameter is called play, so play item star colon play, and all my channels that were named channel 1 to channel 25 are now called item 1 colon play to item 25 colon play. And now we want to export that. And the exporting, we first have to change this export mechanism, the export method, which you can do on the common page of that null chop that comes after the rename. So select the null chop, go onto the common page on the parameters, and in export method, switch it from that table by index to channel name as path parameter. And now I need to turn on exporting, which is done with this little flag here called the export flag. And one is selected already, so it's playing. It's very quiet. And you already can switch between sounds now. Okay. I'm just going to turn off my audio device out. It has an active parameter. So by turning it off, it's not getting too wild. So it's playing, but it's not crossfading between them currently. So how can we crossfade this whole thing? Well, we would be controlling volume. And what we want to do is when a channel comes on, it should be fading in the volume. And when it turns off, it should be fading out. And this is a prime case to use a filter chop. So in a new branch here, after the fan, let's add a filter chop. So middle mouse click on the output of the fan and find the filter. And this is not the audio filter, but the filter chop, which is in the second column all the way at the bottom or somewhere there. So filter. And now if I move my slider around, you can see how differently it behaves from the, like the channels jump around initially, but with the filter chops, they actually go from like they nicely fade up and down. And now to export this onto the volume parameter, I would have to do the same thing that I just did with the play parameter. So let's add a rename chop after the filter chop. Rename. And rename the from field should be chan star. And the to field should again be item star colon. And the parameter name is volume. Okay. And to export, I'll add a null chop. On the null chop, I have to change the export method as I did before because I want to export by channel name as path parameter. So on the null chop, go to the comment page and the export method parameter change to channel name as path parameter. And then enable the exporting by clicking the export flag. So I'm gonna listen in, but I know that it's not right yet. Because whenever I switch, what's happening is that this channel that's currently controlling the play will turn off instantly while the volume is still fading down. But I want it to turn off after the volume or when the volume faded to zero. So I somehow have to take these filter channels and control the play with them. But the play is a toggle. It's not like it's not a slider that you can control, it's a toggle. So out of these channels that are fading between 0 and 1, we need to make again a channel that is on when the value of this filter is still above 0. And that's something the logic chop can do amazingly. So we need to insert a logic chop after the filter that goes to the rename, to the first rename that we made. So let's middle mouse click to create a new branch. Middle mouse click onto the output of the filter chop and find the logic. So you should have this logic kind of dangling around. And this is already by default, it has the right settings for me to, you see how they're staying on, these channels stay on while the input channels are still fading. And the output from the logic, I'll connect to the first rename that's controlling our play. So it should look something like this. And now you're crossfading between them. You're playing them, the play turns on whenever the volume starts going up, and it only turns off when the volume is zero. You can kind of follow this also when you see the channels playing here. Like you see that multiples are turning on. Any questions to that? Because this would be a finished installation that you can display now. Yes. So, that's basically the look of it. So what we did here is we filter whatever is coming in from the fan to make it possible to fade the volume up and down. That's why the filter is there. And then the renames are so we can rename it to control to do easier exporting for us. And we rename the channels to basically have the name of the chop that the channel should be exported to and the parameter name. And the logic is there so that the play doesn't turn off before the volume goes down fully to zero. This would be in the mass chop, the combined chops add. And this again is one of those examples where this element here can be replaced by any input that gives position. So this could be a mouse, this could be a camera, that tracks hands or whatever. OSC in. $50,000, we just need to find a good sensors. What should we use? Let's see what makes sense. Start. I guess it would be gravity would be useful. Why sense of smell. That's the network. I'm having trouble with the network, basically. That's why these samples are not coming in. But yeah, sure, I can take the gravity here. Gravity. And rename that to V1, V2. And the value range that's coming in is minus 1 to 1, so I'm going to change that to be 0 to 1 as well. No, I'm basically controlling that with the with my phone. Yeah. So yes. Any questions about this?
Thank you. found that some of these audio cards, they have their own fade in as well.
So if that's the case, the audio file in also has a trim option. So you could trim off a bit from the start and a bit from the end to keep it from fading in and fading out, but starting right away. One thing that's important to see, these a lot of these parameters have the secondary parameter in the back, which for trim, for example, here is set to S for seconds. So this parameter actually, you're specifying the trim in seconds at the start and the end. It's not very useful in this case. It's much better to work with fractions. Fractions meaning that everything now is between 0 and 1. So now you could trim off the first 10% by setting this, the trim start to 0.1. It would get rid of the first 10% of the file. But yeah, this is these secondary menus, they can be very can be a tricky thing when you think it should be working the way you, well, want it to work, and then they are messing with you because they are set to fraction or they are set to seconds or to frames or something like that. Be aware that a lot of these parameters have this secondary menu, which defines the value context, basically. And if you make this change, then in our setup, you always would have to hit recreate all operators for this change in the master node to take effect in all the replicants. And it disconnected. Yes. So that's this for chops for me. There's another little example in the, or maybe save this file. File save as sound grid. There's another little example for sound and chops, which explains chops in a different way in the folder that I shared with you. And this one is called the simple synth here. What the simple synth, and it comes with the instructions, so you can follow along the instructions for it. The thing, if you look at Touch Designer conceptually, then what it's based on is basically analog synthesizers, where you have a block that does something, and then you take control voltage and plug it into something else and affect the signal with it in a certain way from that. So Touch is built in a very similar, or with that in mind, and therefore it can be fun to actually create a synthesizer from it. In the file you will find a little image, which is a very simple synthesizer in a what do you call this, like a schematic. And if you zoom a little bit around, you can overlay all these elements that you have in a basic synthesizer patch for an analog synthesizer with the operators that are the same in Touch Designer. And what this gives you is, that's on. Basically the simplest little synthesizer that you can imagine with a little visualization on top of it. So we'll be looking at the visualization part next, especially because this is a nice simple visualization. It's easy to do. But if you want to build this synthesizer part, then yeah, have a look at that folder. And again, the instructions are in the same folder, so you can recreate this whole thing. Okay, I hope I explained CHOPS fairly well with that. There's lots to it. CHOP networks can get really large, and but they're very, very interesting to follow. Okay, and this will take us now to SOPs, to surface operators. After we created textures and played with textures a bit, we did now CHOPs, controlled sound with it, or build little logic networks. So let's get to surface operators. And surface operators basically being all the 3D in Touch Designer. So let's see. I just open up a fresh file for that. And I delete the default network and close the palette. And now I'm gonna take you a little bit through the SOPs. The easiest thing to show how SOPs are working is literally by creating a sphere SOP. So open up the upgrade dialog when you have a fresh file, or just scroll the old file a little bit in your network up. That's also ways possible too. And find the sphere SOP. And you should be seeing something like this. Now, if you activate the viewer, and we did that previously with the default synth that's shown in Touch Designer when you open it up, you can interact with that viewer. It's a 3D viewer, so you can inspect it from all sides. And that's a generator. It generates a shape. And now you can also use filters on this. And one of the filters, again, always useful, is the noise. So attach a noise sub to the sphere. And this is essentially what's happening here. We have the sphere, and we are applying positional noise to that sphere. So we are offsetting each point by a certain noise value. And that's the result of the whole thing. If you're inspecting if you're activating the viewer and inspecting the whole thing, you can also have a look at the wireframe of it by hitting W. So you get a wireframe view of the whole thing. While the other one is basically a simple shaded representation of the whole thing. Now, there's a set of tools in Touch Designer for importing your own models. And this is quite important if you're dealing with 3D and if you're dealing with complex 3D, because Touch Designer at the moment doesn't provide you with the most advanced modeling tools that are out there. You're much better to model in a tool that you that you're familiar with, that you're comfortable with, and then bring those models into Touch Designer via various formats. One of those formats that I should mention, it's fairly new, or it's new that we have it inside Touch Designer, would be Alembic. And Alembic being a 3D format that it can also import whole animation sequences. Meaning, and unfortunately I don't have an Alembic file with me, but the nice thing about it is that you have access to the animation via its time, so you can control the playback of the animation directly from here, from the node. Another way of importing models would be FBX. And I have one example for an FBX with me, which is just takes a bit to import. This is also an animation, so it's a model and an animation is included, and the animation is done by our deform shaders. But it's an export from a 3D package, so most 3D packages export FBX files and export whole scenes, including cameras, textures, and lighting, and as well as deforms. So here, where is it? Here we go. So it's basically importing this dinosaur as a full-on animation for you. And you can, since it's a geometry, it's a non-rendered geometry, so you can still shade it any way you like it or light it any way you need to. Alembic. Alembic. Sorry?
It's under SOPs.
It's under SOPs, yeah. It should be the second one. If it's not there, then you need to update. Yeah. But you can get, it's the late, or it's also in the latest release that's on the website. Yeah. Okay, gonna delete that again. Another good one to mention, another good, very powerful SOP would be the copy SOP. And it can do quite a bit of things with very simple inputs. For example, I take a line SOP and attach a copy SOP to it. And now I can create, 100 copies. And use these translate parameters to cumulatively translate each copy that is being made. So by changing the, for example, the rotate, you can create these kind of shapes with it. It's a lot of fun to play around with them, basically, with these copy parameters in the cumulative mode. Rotation, also scale. Hope it doesn't scale, obviously, in XY and Y. Scales in X. And if you think about the idea that you can animate any of these parameters or animate the input as well, then you can imagine that you can create quite complex line graphics with it. It's also worthwhile looking at the help page for the copy SOP, because at the bottom of it is a little example. If you just rebuild this example, it gives you a good idea of what you can do with the copy SOP as well, which is define parameters that can be passed back to its input. So this is called stamping. You define a stamp parameter, and then the input to the copy SOP has access to the stamped parameter. So every copy then can look differently. In this example here, you create, you start with a triangle, and with each copy you create more corners. I should have mentioned that much earlier. A lot of these techniques, there's a book called Generative Design that came out a while ago, which was fully based on processing, and we kind of went out and recreated a lot of those examples in Touch Designer. So if you're on our wiki and you look for generative design, then you find all of these examples in downloadable zip files. If you have the book, I can absolutely recommend the book, then you can also see the translation between processing and Touch Designer as a process if you're more used to processing side of things. And a lot of these examples use the copy SOP, for example. Now, the copy SOP is one thing where you can do really nice things with it, but it bogs down your performance quite a bit, because as subs are currently, a lot of that is their legacy, and a lot of them take a hit on the CPU. So they're not very performative in a way. They could be faster. But one of the things which you can replace the copy sub with is a technique that I'll go into in a second, called instancing, where you take a copy of the geometry, it's being uploaded to the GPU, and then any of the transforms and copying is done on the GPU, which is much lighter, much faster, and you can do way more complex things than driving only animation channels. But we'll get to that in a second. So, due to time constraints, I'm going to jump into a section that we will look at how to render this thing. Because what we currently have, we have a 3D element. So it's something that's has texture coordinates, has point positions. But what we don't have is a rendered representation of this. Like, we don't have pixels, so to say. We need this to be converted into tops. And to render a 3D scene requires a couple simple components, and definitely something to remember. First, just remember how it's done, and then later you can, if there's things that are not quite clear right away, then that's something to learn after. But so maybe put down a sphere sub and attach a noise. And when you have that, what we need to do first is convert or bring this object, which is currently in model space, we need to bring this into world space, where it's kind of, in a sense, closer connected to the camera, to the light, and pretty much that's it. And the node that does this is a component, and it's called the geometry component. So to add this all together into a render scene, right click on the output of the noise sub, and in the upgrade dialog, go to the component section, and there find the geometry. It's in the first column. And I'm doing a weird thing here, because that shouldn't happen. I'm connecting a different family to this sub. So it's kind of a shortcut. What you can do, and this is special for components only, is you can attach components in a way to other operator families. But what's actually happening is that inside of this component, it just adds an in and an out node, and then connects it. Because by default, the geometry, and I'm just gonna put it down to show you, by default, the geometry component doesn't have an input. You would have to build things up differently. So to quickly get going with a rendered scene, what I usually do is right click on the output of the sub that I want to render, go to the component section, pick the geometry, and it's connected. The next thing we need is a camera. So double click to bring up the upgrade dialog and find a camera. And last but not least, we also need a light. So hit tab again and find a light in the comp section. Those are all components. And this gives us the basic requirements for a render. We have the geometry, we have the camera, and we have the light. So the last thing missing here is the node that converts the geometry into a texture, into a top. And this is done via the render top. So the last thing to place down is the open up the upgrade dialog, go into the top page, and find the render top. and that's already all the difference here. Here I can navigate, I can tumble the 3D object. While here in the render node, which is a top, which is a texture operator, it's flat. It's just pixels. I have color information, while here I have positional information. But now you can control your view with the camera. The camera comes with all kinds of parameters to control your field of views. Via the lights, you have controls for light colors. You have control over the light type, point, cone, or distance light. We do have things like environment lights as well. So if you like, you can place down an environment light, which requires a texture. And I supplied a texture in the folder that I gave you, an environment texture, which would be under HDR, Barcelona rooftop, and you can drag that just into the file. It creates a little movie file in top, which you can reference on the environment map parameter. It's in the media HDR.
Question: where did you get that environment token?
I got the environment light as well in the comp section of the upgrade dialog. Yeah. And another thing that might be interesting for rendering that we added recently is, the thing that we haven't added yet actually in general is the material, which would be also required if you don't just want to have a flat shaded model here. And so we have different material types. One of the default things you could use would be a thong, for example, but another material that we have recently added is something called PBR materials, which is physically based rendering, giving much nicer results for your renders, much more realistic looking. We have these PBR materials. These maps can be driven by something called this in correlation to this PBR. We also have added something called the substance top, which you can use as an input to the PBR material, and the substance top being a top that reads in materials made with something called Substance Designer, which is a software out there to create realistically looking materials. The nice thing about Substance Designer and these materials is that Substance Designer, not abuse. Jesus, what are people thinking? This is, anyway. Substance Designer has a large library of free materials. So you can, I think it's under community, perhaps substance share. I think you need a login. Well, anyway, when it comes up, the large library of free materials, and you can download them and then load them into the substance top. And from there, you can select the various graphs that usually, so the various types of materials that come with that downloaded one. And and then you reference it in the substance top, substance material. And to apply a material to a geometry, you have to somehow tell this geometry to use this material. And you can do this on the render page of the geo component. So when you select the geometry on the render page, there's a material parameter, and there drag the PBR onto. Right away when doing this, this render complains, and it complains because there's no tangents defined. Tangents are missing. And you can create those tangents. You have to do this in the subworld by adding an attribute create sub, which lets you compute tangents. If you want to adjust the texture itself, like the mapping of the whole thing, you can create you can do this with a texture sub. And for example, you can just make it a little bit finer. And you also now see the effect more of the environment light around it. Or that's... Oh, sure, yeah.
When you brought the PBR,
So after I put the PBR down, one thing with the PBR is that either you have to define all these maps, like you can import them separately, or you can use something called a substance top, which combines all of these required materials, base color, specular, metallic, all of these would be combined in one top that comes from a specific library. And so I created a substance top, which you find in the top family, substance. And then reference this substance top on the substance top parameter of the PBR material. This material or the substance designer file that comes with Touch Designer, there's various materials that you can select from. And I selected the checker. Sorry? Oh, right, in the texture settings, I just... So what was happening is that by default, it's fairly large. The texture is applied as a fairly large block onto the noisy sphere. So I scaled it. I scaled the texture coordinates, which means when you scale the texture coordinates, you're actually it's basically reverse scaling. So if you increase the scale on the texture coordinates, the image is gonna get smaller. The texture is gonna get smaller. The static? Oh, the warning. Yeah, the warning was something I had to add in an attribute create sub to calculate the tangents, which is specifically needed for the PBR material. So it's attribute create and then compute tangents.
Do you mind taking a lot of pictures?
something to give you the time to be ready. I can go ahead and cross up and fill it at any point. I got lost in the mall of them.
So, so this is a little bit of speed walk through render setups. The important thing to remember about this setup is that you have your SOPs. And you do something with your SOPs, it doesn't matter really what, it's just either an imported file, an imported animation, or some generative thing that you build with using SOPs and using chops or something. And this part here is perhaps the important part to remember, that you right click and create a geo component. And then you add a camera and a light and a render top. Those are the base requirements. The PBR material was just bonus basically right now. Doesn't really matter. Could be anything else. These nodes are the important ones. You need a camera, you need a light, you need the geo component and the render. There are more flags on the geo components themselves as well as on the SOPs or on the components that deal with geometry. And these are one of them that's gonna come up is the render flag here, which basically turns rendering on or off. So that's easily missed. If something is not in your scene, then the render flag is probably not on. The other thing is that the default render node, it looks at one camera, cam one by default, so that's already set in. And then it looks at all geometries because the geometry parameter is marked with a star. And it also looks at all lights. So all the lights in your scene will be included into this render. So it can be confusing when you add somewhere else in your scene, you add another geometry, and suddenly you end up with this geometry in that render. And you might not want that. Then it would become important that on the render top, you specify the geometry that you actually want to render. So I just want to render Geo1, I don't want to render Geo2. So I type in here Geo1. So you specify particularly the geometries that you actually want to render. You have, I might mention that for things like VR goggles and things like that. The way you would set up a VR rig is very similar to our default setting up a render scene. So you have a camera, but you not just one camera now, you have two cameras. You have one for your left eye and one for your right eye. And you have the same geometry, the same light usually. And then you have two renders, one for your left eye, one for your right eye. And in the end, you have an output node, which is the OpenVR output. So this would send it, it sends two renders, your left eye and your right eye render, to the VR equipment that you have, the Oculus or the Vive. There is, to make this easier, in the palette there is a couple components that help you with setting up these scenes. There's a very simple Vive setup and a rather simple, where is it, the Oculus Rift. I highly recommend this one. It's a good it's a good trip. And one nice thing also about this, you have access, the way that we do this in Touch Designer, you have access to each eye separately. You don't render the scene as one, but you have access to each eye. So nothing keeps you from you could delay this eye a little bit. So if you delay one eye with a cache top a little bit, like, I don't know, half a second or something, it's great effects. So anyway, basically I don't know what to use VR for. I just try to freak out my brain somehow. That's the
so
yeah,
just to complete this, you got render one is left, create render two is right. When I created them, they're connected to the same GM.
Right.
How do you offset the eyes?
So you would need both. Yeah, I didn't finish my thought there. In the Oculus Rift Simple, it's nicely shown that just close this. You have two cameras. You have a camera for the left eye and one for the right eye. So it's important to specify them in each render, the left cam and the right cam. And then the position of the camera needs to be coming from the goggles itself. And for that you use the Oculus Rift chop which brings in the whole matrix, the camera matrix for the left eye and the camera matrix for the right eye. And you specify them in the transform matrix parameter of the camera. So this example, the Oculus Rift Simple, is also in the palette. It's really worthwhile looking at just because it's so, it's pretty simple. You just have a geometry. I don't even know where the geometry is. Oh, down here. This red stuff here, that's the geometry part. So it could be just a sphere, basically, like just a simple thing. And then this part is what you don't necessarily need to change, or what you shouldn't change. Just see how it's set up and how it's using the Oculus operators to control the camera offset for each eye. And so if you delete all of this, for example, you could just place a sphere here. Geometry and a light, and well, you have a material already anyway, so if I offset that, so you could render a simple sphere in VR like that, that you then can look around.
Does that take in all the positional tracking data?
Yes, it includes the positional tracking data from the Oculus Rift, which comes in via this one, and then we're offsetting the camera by it. That's the transforms. This is the size. This matrix. Well, no, the positional data comes in via these nodes, yeah, per camera. Correct. Yeah. Same with the wife. Literally, same process. So, as we're running out of time increasingly, I think I want to show you, I would like to repeat one step, which is outputting onto a full screen. I think that's important to repeat because we just did it in the very beginning. And it's a process that is interesting enough, especially when you want to output to multiple screens as well. So in our render scene here that we created, I just added a null top to the output of the render. And what we did very, very in the beginning this morning, we added a window component. So let's add this window component again. And the basics of this window component is literally that it needs to know an operator that it should be outputting full screen. So what we want to output is the null one here, and we can drag it onto there. We can drag the null onto the operator parameter. And then we have a couple settings again, which would be the opening size, which in most cases we want as a fill. We want to fill the whole screen. And the other important parameter is the borders toggle. By default, when we would open up this window, it would open up with a border. So most cases you want to turn that off. And now we have down at the bottom all these different options here. I told you click open as separate window, which is fine. It opens it, full screen, looks fine, good. But what's actually happening is that it opens a separate window on top of the Touch Designer interface, meaning you're kind of doing more work than necessary. in most cases, when you have an installation or anything, you don't need access to the interface anymore because you're displaying whatever you're displaying. So for this, there is this thing called Perfume Window. What OpenS Perfume Window does is it actually closes down the network editor and opens up only the renderer as a high-performance render. So there's no more nodes being drawn in the background. All the viewers are not drawn anymore, which gives you extra cycles on your GPU. The only thing that's being drawn is actually this one window. There's only one touch designer window at the moment here. This one. Again, as a separate window, I still have my other touch designer window working as well. So as a perform window is usually the one that you would choose when you wanna when you're ready to display that and you want to see it at full performance. Open a separate window can be useful if you have your interface on one screen and you want to output the result on the other and still work in it. Because you can specify the monitor index, which monitor you want to output this to. So, just for, well, that kind of doesn't make sense. Basically, if I have a second monitor connected to here, currently I'm mirroring, but if I would have a second monitor connected, then I would set this to monitor one, where I want to output it, and then it's going to complain now if I try to do this, but open this as a second window on the second monitor. There's also a shortcut there's a whole dialogue for this window placement management, because you can have multiple window components in your project. You could use these window components to open up little pop-up windows that not necessarily should be part of your scene, for example. So there's a case for having multiple of those. Now you could have one main one that you want to have as your main perform window, and possibly you want to start with that perform window active, like you want to start in full screen mode always. And you can do this by setting start in perform mode, enabling that in the window placement dialog. The window placement dialog, again, you can get at the bottom of the parameters. And then you would have to select which one of these window components that you currently have in your system should be the perform window. And for me, this would be the project one window one. Here, project one window one. Okay, this now has two effects. I enabled that it should open up in perform mode when I restart the file. So it will only open up the full screen renderer. And the other thing is, if I now hit F1, then I have basically a shortcut key for this perform window now. No matter where I am in my project, I can always hit F1, get this message. You don't get this message normally if you have the right monitor ID, and it opens up this perform window. Now, what if you want to have, what if you display on two screens, for example, like you want to span across two screens? There's a little bit of, an issue with drivers, etc. And every single window that you open will take down your performance. I could. You see that my performance now took a huge hit by just opening up this window, which is weird. And therefore, if you open up two of them, you lose more performance. And if you open it in perform mode, but you open You can only open up one of those windows in perform mode, so you would have to have one perform mode window, one regular window, losing frame rate. So what you would have to do to actually open up just, you just want to open up one large canvas, therefore. And one way to do this would be using, for example, a constant top and defining the canvas size of your full canvas. So 1280, whoops, times 2 by 720 or something. And now compositing your two screens over it. Probably should do this. So I would just set up my composite here and put it into the right position, and now take my second one, which I'll change a little bit. Da-dum. And translate step that one over. And now I could use this one canvas to open up across two monitors. So you only have one perform window, which you get at full without performance impact. So you don't want to open up two windows. That's basically the main story here. Always one window. The other way that this might be done is by using containers, because the window component itself can just display anything. You can even take a wave chop and display the wave chop in full screen mode. So it takes any kind of operator to display here, including these container components. And these container components are basically empty containers with a certain size. So I can give this one a size of 1280 by 720. And one thing that you can do with these container components is you can give them a background. On the look page, you can define colors, but also a background top. So I can reference this one here, my first, and I copy paste this and reference my second one. And now I would want to combine these two containers together. And this is a whole topic we didn't get into, but you can combine those vertically. You see how all our structure is horizontally here? Those containers you can combine vertically. That's why they have an input and an output on top and bottom. They're inheriting positions and sizes, basically. So this main container here, I could now scale up to 1280 times 2 by 720. So I have my white canvas. Then connect these two together. They're currently showing up in the same spot, but containers have the ability to align their children left to right. And now I have my big canvas with those two aligned properly, and I can use this not as the clone master. That doesn't work. But as the operator. And if I had two screens to show this on, I could now open this up as one canvas again. This way. This is a little cleaner than the other way I just showed you before, the compositing way, because you have more, it just feels more right. It probably uses the same amount of texture memory, I'm not sure, but it also, yeah, gets you going with building canvases this way. Definitely the preferred approach.